Hi, for those of you who are new to my channel, welcome. My name is Mike Hansen. I'm a board certified physician specializing in internal medicine, pulmonary disease, and critical care medicine. In this video, I'm going to discuss updates with the COVID surge that is here, controlling the pandemic, immunity to the virus, possible treatments on the horizon, and more. The COVID-19 pandemic is at its worst right now. Hospitalizations are the best measure of how the nation is faring against the pandemic, and surges in hospitalizations leads to surges in deaths. This pandemic is going to be at its worst in the next 2 to 3 months. As of the making of this video, in the US, there are 80 to 90,000 new cases per day. Texas has about 8,000 new cases per day. Wisconsin, over 5,000. Over the past week in the United States, new cases have increased 18%. But the number of new tests being performed has only increased by 4%. In South Dakota, half the tests that are being done are positive. To put that in perspective, ideally, you want the test positivity rate at or below 5% for at least 14 days before you reopen a certain part of the country. Of course, South Dakota is not closed. The US total death toll is now over 230,000. And how many people are there who got COVID but now are recovering with home oxygen, or maybe they have a tracheostomy in their neck and now they require long-term acute care? I have a lot of patients who are 3-4 months out from their COVID illness and they're still requiring supplemental oxygen. But we still don't know the total number of these long haulers because it's not being tracked, or at least it hasn't been from the beginning. And as if COVID-19 by itself is not bad enough, it has a domino effect on the rest of our society. It's not just the economy that suffers, it's also the rest of healthcare in general that suffers. And this is not to mention the increased rates of depression and suicide deaths during these times. If hospitals are overwhelmed, guess what happens to the other care of patients who don't have COVID? Cancer treatment becomes delayed. Elective surgeries are being put off for things like heart surgery, hip replacement, and more. Also, who wants to go to a doctor's office or an ER or an urgent care center during these times and possibly get COVID? It's not like we don't know how to get this pandemic under control. It can be done. Look at how well other countries handled it and how well they're doing and how well their economies are doing. Australia, New Zealand, South Korea, Taiwan, and even the country where it all started, China. China has a total of, wait for it, less than 5,000 deaths total from COVID. What do all these countries have in common? Well, they did testing, contact tracing, quarantine, distancing, and masks. This pandemic is only going to get worse in the next couple of months, and more hospitals will be overwhelmed. The difference between what's happening now compared to what happened during the previous spike in cases is that the entire country is now a hotspot. And because it's so widespread, we will soon reach a breaking point in our hospitals and our number of healthcare workers. In all likelihood, one of three things is going to happen. One, there's going to be a federal mask mandate because not enough people are wearing masks when they should be. If this doesn't happen, there will likely be a shutdown of most of the country. If neither of these things happen, it will be millions of deaths and an absolutely destroyed economy. Some people say doctors are inflating the numbers.
Our doctors get more money if somebody dies from COVID. You know that, right?
So this is not true. Part of my job as an ICU physician is to complete a death certificate. And I have to write the primary cause of death and the secondary causes of death. There's usually a chain of events that causes someone to die. Lots of times there are multiple contributing factors that lead to someone's death. But usually, we know the primary cause of death. And with COVID-19, it's pretty straightforward. For example, let's say someone has diabetes, high blood pressure, and is obese, and they're a smoker. Let's say they get COVID, they get COVID pneumonia, and they develop ARDS, and they end up requiring a breathing tube in the hospital, and eventually they die. Well, they died of COVID-19. They have other medical problems as secondary contributors, but the primary cause of death in that instance, it's obvious. Ultimately, the question is, did they die sooner than they would have if they didn't have COVID? Sometimes it can be somewhat of a gray area. For example, let's say someone has COVID-19 pneumonia, they're severely ill in the ICU requiring a breathing tube, And sometimes these patients get a secondary bacterial infection, a secondary bacterial pneumonia, and that can contribute or hasten their death. Did they die of COVID? Did they die of the bacterial pneumonia? Well, the answer is they died of both, but it was primarily the COVID-19 that was the driver in that situation. Also, regarding the claim that doctors get paid more based on the diagnosis, it's a lie, plain and simple. My paycheck is the same regardless of a patient's diagnosis. I don't get paid any more or less whether they have COVID or something else. Are people immune to the virus after they are infected? Antibodies are made by the body in response to a given infection or a specific vaccine. Usually, antibodies protect someone from future infection of that same virus or bacteria. And these antibodies that are developed are called neutralizing antibodies. Researchers at Mount Sinai's health system between March and October looked at the antibody responses of more than 30,000 people who tested positive for COVID-19. These people who had COVID had either mild or moderate illness. In that study, they described their antibody responses as either being low, moderate, or high. More than 90% had moderate to high levels of these neutralizing antibodies to the spike protein of the virus, and the response was maintained for at least 5 months. So, can you get infected with COVID-19 twice based on this? Probably not. If it does occur, it's the exception, not the rule. And this study also has implications when it comes to immunity from a vaccine. It's likely that a vaccine will provide immunity, but for how long is another question. Based on this study, the answer is most likely at least 5 months, but this is still not known for sure. It's also unlikely when this vaccine will become available. It's most likely going to be available for healthcare workers and the most vulnerable of the population come spring of 2021. But what happens after that, where it's available to the rest of the public? Most likely a year from now. And then there's the other question of how many people are actually willing to get the vaccine. You know, a question that I get asked a lot is, are you willing to get the vaccine? And the answer is yes, as long as the scientific studies show that it is both safe and effective. In a recent study done at the University of Maryland, people who were hospitalized for COVID-19, who were previously taking a daily low-dose aspirin, had a significantly lower risk of COVID-19 complications and death compared to those who were not taking a low-dose aspirin, meaning 81 milligrams of aspirin, also known as a baby aspirin. The ones who took the baby aspirin, they were less likely to require ICU level of care and less likely to require a breathing tube. Does this mean that everyone should be taking a daily 81 milligram dose of aspirin to prevent severe COVID? No, at least not until there are randomized controlled trials to prove that it's both safe and effective. Generally speaking, taking a daily 81 milligram dose of aspirin is safe, but does have a slightly higher risk of side effects such as bleeding. Also, on a related note, now is really not a good time to be vitamin D deficient. And that's something I talk more about in two of my other videos on this channel, so you can check that out if you want. There are over 70 monoclonal antibody treatments that are being looked at for COVID-19. They're in various stages of development. The two that have the most potential right now are the ones that are made by Eli Lilly and Regeneron. Both of these companies have already applied for FDA emergency use authorizations. Eli Lilly recently signed a $375 million deal with the government for 300,000 vials of this monoclonal antibody. It's called Bamlanivimab. I'm just going to call it the B word for short. There's a recent study in the New England Journal of Medicine that looked at Bamlanivimab, or the B word, and it seemed to decrease the risk of hospitalization and ease some symptoms in this phase 2 trial that involved over 400 patients with either mild to moderate COVID-19. In this randomized controlled trial, less than 2% of patients who received the B word had symptoms progress enough to the point of requiring hospitalization or a trip to the ER. And for those who received placebo, it was 6%. Now, for the group of patients who were in the higher risk category, defined as those who were obese or older than 65, 4% who got the treatment were hospitalized, compared to 15% in the placebo group. The primary goal of the study was to see if the treatment eliminated the virus by day 11, which it did for the vast majority of patients. So overall, the results of this study are encouraging, but there still needs to be a bigger study to know for sure its effectiveness. Now, in a different trial, the B word was evaluated in more severe COVID patients who were hospitalized, but the study was terminated early because it just wasn't working. All right, so what about the other major monoclonal antibody made by Regeneron called REGN-COV2? This is the same treatment that President Trump received. Well, there was also a study done in which they gave REGN-COV2 for COVID-19 patients with mild to moderate disease, but the details of the study were not published in a medical journal, and they've not been peer-reviewed either. According to Regeneron, they said that the treatment significantly reduced viral load, and it also reduced the need for people to seek medical attention either at a hospital or a doctor's office or an urgent care center. So as of right now, we still don't have any great treatment for COVID-19, especially when it comes to those with severe disease. Also, we might know a lot of the risk factors that put certain people at higher risk of having severe COVID, but we still don't know, or we still don't have a way to predict who's going to become severely ill with cytokine storm and ARDS. But just last week, there was a new study that can help us predict who will become severely ill with COVID with a high degree of accuracy. And that's what my next video is going to be on. So make sure you hit the bell notification if you haven't done so already. That way you can be notified of when that video is ready. And just want to say thanks for watching. Stay safe, stay healthy, and I'll see you in the next one.